demon who been called to be that, to literally shake this world in the right way. And that's what he does. He's a thief. He took your gift and used it for his glory. That's what he did. Get us on drugs and just get us listening to every thought, giving into the flesh and doing what he's called us to do. His plan, right? But here, this is where it all intersects, man. This is where God starts to change things. Hallelujah. So, anyways, I'm going to try my best to teach on Philippians 4. Therefore, my beloved brethren, my joy and crown, so stand fast in the Lord, beloved. I implore you, Diana, I implore Syntyche to be of the same mind in the Lord. And I urge you also to prepare and help these women who labor with me in the gospel with Clement, also the rest of my fellow workers who came for the book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I'll say, rejoice. Let your gentleness be made known to all men. The Lord is at hand. Be anxious for nothing, but in prayer with everything with prayer, supplication and thanksgiving. Let your request be made known to God, and the peace of God which surpasses all understanding will guard your heart and your mind. We want to get this word of God into us. Guys, before I start talking on this, if you want to be strong in the Lord, you have got to be in the Word of God. And for me, you stay in the Word of God because my mind will go so many places. I memorize the Word of God. And I don't know about you guys, but my mind can go weird places if I haven't get it fixed on something. You ever have that happen? You ever just chilling and you're like, whoa! Where'd that go? They're not letting him know what I was thinking. And it's just, when you start to get into the Word and you start to memorize, you'll start to see how the enemy attacks. You'll see his assaults. You'll start to realize how he tries to plague your mind all day long. And here's what works. He throws the thought, but you act on the thought. You invite the thought, you let it take root and grow, and then we struggle. And then we'll spend our whole life trying to figure out what's wrong with us. You start reading the Bible to see what it is. Pretty simple. You were born in a sinful nature. It's that simple. You were born in a sinful nature that what? Sins. So yours manifested the way it did. That's all it is, man. And when we get saved, God renews our mind in the things of God. And we stop trying to figure it out and we start moving forward. Amen? That's what Paul just got done saying in Philippians chapter 3. Not going to go pressing toward the goal for the prize. So in Philippians, he says, therefore, my beloved and longed-for brethren, my joy and crown shall stand fast in the Lord beloved. Joy and crown, he's talking about athletes. Talking about when they were athletic in that time and how hard they would compete for that crown. But earlier, I was mocking a little bit, but I'm serious. We get this attitude that I'm going to kind of drift. If you drift, you're going in the flesh. I guarantee it, man. You drift, you're going in the flesh. That's the way the river drifts. That's the way it goes. This is an upstream paddle, man. But God gave you the tools that you need to do it. But if you just go on idle, man, the flesh will take strength quick. You've got to choose every day to put the Word of God in you. Your flesh and the devil are never going to encourage that. Never. In fact, they'll both bring up all kinds of other possibilities that will never strengthen the spirit. And then we just give into the flesh. So he wants a mindset there of joy and by joy and crown. You're going to have to fight for this. But I was trying to lay out the clue this morning. If you think this is just random people coming in to talk about random things, you missed it. These are people that God has preserved, anointed, and saved to bring before you, to bring forth truth. To discern the Word of God, to discern good and evil, to be able to bring forth the Word of God that will give you strength in the time of need. Amen? To encourage you to read the Bible, to encourage you to pray. Once you start doing that, you're going to go from being babies in the Lord to being grown and mature. Because now you're feeding on the Word of God. You're feeding on God. You're praying to God. Right? That's what we want to do. We all start off right there. And all of a sudden, when we start to get an attitude and says, get out of my way, you're not reading the Bible. Nothing's stopping me from getting rid of the Word. Oh, world's trying to take that Bible, man. They're just burning Bibles to purpose. People are after it, man. People are trying to destroy the Word of God, man. Always. But that's normal around most of the world. So stand fast in what? Stand fast in Jesus. What else is standing in? When we stood in the drugs, what did those do? When we stood fast in our drug addiction, when we stood fast in the principles of the drug world. I don't know about you guys, but all my friends that stayed in it are dead or in prison, literally. Or I got a couple left that was crazy. Hard to talk to them. You ever try to talk to someone that's been on meth for 40 years? It's hard, man. It's hard to get. They get you looking over your shoulder. Right? You know what I'm talking about? You know what I'm talking about. I get it, man. I have friends trying to, it's scarce just to go in the store to get Mountain Dew or something. It's bad. But we're standing firm, we're staying fast in Jesus. That means no matter what the world says, no matter what names we're called, no matter what threats are brought, we're not backing down. We're about Jesus and about truth. No matter what the world does. And here's the kicker, man. When the world comes after you, the Holy Spirit will rise up in you if you have the Holy Spirit. And that Holy Spirit will shine truth and love like the world has never seen. Amen. And the world always can kill it, man. That's because the world can't handle the truth. But when they see a truth greater than their deception, man, it wakes them up. Sometimes we gotta die so others can live. I hope that you're those men. I hope that you're not gonna be more what we've had going on in our country, man. Sleeping church. I hope you are men that'll be alive to Christ, alive to the truth, and when he says something, you'll be like, I'll go. Oh, no one else is going to that spot, I'll go. I'll walk in there with the Bible. I hope that there's men of God that'll do that, man. I'm looking for those men. I'm looking for those who are willing to go forward, man. Now I'm going to die anyways. Why not die for truth? Wouldn't that be a good thing to die for truth? Hallelujah. So in verse 2 in chapter 4, Paul goes on. By the way, this is written by Apostle Paul, and Paul was in jail when he wrote this. This is called the Joy Book, the Book of Joy, and he wrote it while he was in jail. I want you to get that. This is Paul writing this while he was locked up for preaching the gospel. The Joy Book. Before I go on with this, how many times in our mind is like, if I could just get out of here, if I could just get this, and this, and then I'll be happy. No, you won't. Because as soon as you have that, then you're going to want the next thing. And the next thing, and the next thing, and the next thing. I've been here for years, man. I've watched so many men say, man, I just got to get off paper. If I can just get off paper, I'll be good. You got to get off the paper of your heart. You got to get God to change things from the inside out, or you're just going to go after another vain pursuit. Even if you overcome the drugs, you'll go after the other vain thing on this earth. Money, riches, whatever, that'll leave you empty anyway. Stand fast in the Lord. This time is short. Guys, I'm 42. Bam! That was quick. A couple times we slow had an infection too, that was pretty slow. But even that has gone by. Right? Stay on my feet. Listen to me. There are famous people that have sold their soul to the devil, sold their soul to rock and roll. They believe that they made a good deal to get 60 years of fame. Do you know how quick fuel 60 years goes? When we're 60, we're going to be like, what happened? If we make it that far, I don't know. But it goes quick. It goes so fast, and yet people do everything to invest in it, man. Not realizing that the things of the Lord are what matter. That there is a new heaven and a new earth being made forever. All joy and peace. Ain't going to be all this destruction and pain and suffering, anxiety and depression and all this stuff that came from Adam eating from the fruit. It all came. Right after Adam eats the fruit, rebellion comes, Cain kills Abel, murder comes, you know, and then it's on. It's so short.
But when we put our heart and fix our heart to the Lord, then it's just begun. All we're doing is making this little leap into eternity.
Amen.
But if this is all you got, I feel bad, man, because even this won't make you happy. I remember Brian Hay Welsh, man, from Warren. I remember him sharing his testimony when I was talking to him one time. He was sharing about how all his dreams came true. He got to play in Woodstock in 99. He got to play in Woodstock. He got $1 million for it. What if you got a call right now? Hey, come play for $1 million. Be like, all right. He said there was no peace. He said that as soon as he was happy, as soon as it was gone. American dream, right? As much as your mind can imagine, if I can just get this, I'll be happy. You're not. You're not going to have the peace of God unless it's in Christ. Unless Christ has called you to it. You're going to be left pretty empty. So in verse 2, I implore you, die, and I implore Cynthia that you be of the same mind in the Lord. And I urge you also, true companion, help these women who labored with me in the gospel with Clement also and the rest of my fellow workers whose names are in the book of life. Paul's trying to call for unity because they're fighting already. The churches are just at war. And there always has been war. It's sad. You know, most missionaries that have come to America, they all say, man, it's crazy. They say Christians eat their own here. Just fight all the time. But what I want to talk to you about that is to learn the difference between what's major and what's minor. Major is Christ crucified. Right? Christ died, buried, risen again. Salvation's in Christ. That's a major. Now, if someone's telling you there's a different way to be saved, that's a problem. You can't be in unity with that. You can't be in unity with Buddha. There ain't no unity in Buddha. Man, that big fat dead God, man, he ain't gonna do nothing for you, man. False peace. Ain't nothing there, man. Nothing. I reject that, man. Why would you want to follow a fallen angel? Why would you want someone that was close to God, someone that was right there with God, someone that had it all, rejects God, and wants a throne? Why would you listen to him in his false ways? To give you this false version of a quick version of peace that doesn't even lead to anything. Wouldn't you want that supernatural peace that lasts for eternity, that comes from God? So anyways, they're fighting, and people are fighting today. And what I mean by major and minor, there's going to be a lot of minors. Like, okay, here's the minor. The end times. There's this 7-year period where there's going to be what's called the Great Tribulation. That's where the Antichrist comes, and that's where you're going to have one world government, one world money, one world religion. He's going to kill all kinds of Christians. You know, all this stuff's going to happen, right? You can read it. People are fighting about when it's going to happen in that 7 years. Some are saying right at the beginning, some are saying in the middle, and some are saying at the end. And some of them won't even talk to each other because of this. That's the type of stuff he's talking about right there. He's like, come on, man. We got a gospel to preach, and you're all fighting over nonsense. And usually what they were fighting about when you study in church history was who they were of. Well, I'm of Apollos. Now I'm of Paul. Right? I'm of Kenny. Well, I'm of Tommy. Or I'm of Jeremy. You know, stop. We're of Christ. He's your leader. There are good leaders that will lead you to Christ, but let Christ be your leader. He's the one who draws. Well, that's why I'm saying you read the Word. All we are help tools to help you get in the Word. If we're not doing that, then we're not doing a good job. You're supposed to build your relationship with God. Therefore, be imitators of Christ as dear children in Ephesians 5. But there's all kinds of fights. Let me guess, is there fights in here? Once in a while? Paul wants us to grow up. Paul wants us to mature in the faith, and we can't do that apart from Christ. Our flesh is too strong, man. Flesh is just irritated and intolerant and angry and defensive, and it just reacts. It's wrathful. It just has all its issues, man. On top of it, we have our false teachings we have to eradicate, get eradicated by God, you know? And it's all that is mixed up for a good fight, you know? But we need to be in Christ. And Paul's trying to call them to come into unity. Because there was a city called Philippi, that city needs to be saved. That city needs Jesus. One of the things I feel bad for, anytime I see someone new and they get saved, they're like, man, let's change the city. Man, let's reach out, let's do an outreach, let's get the pastors together. And then I already know how that works. But then I got a guy that'd be like, you know what? No, man, maybe you're the one. Amen. I don't want to discourage someone if they've been given something from God. So what if it's been tried over and over? You never know. It could be the one.
Amen.
Could be the one that unifies people, man, in truth and in spirit. But it's got to be truth and spirit, man. It can't be in heresy. A false unity is not true unity, man. Well, false unity would be like the flesh and the devil, you know. We're unified. Don't. Better be alone with Christ than be that kind of unity. But as a church, we're called to unify. And Paul's dealing with the group that is struggling with that. So just so you know, you're not alone. This has been going on since the beginning of the church. So you're not alone if you're trying to figure it out. But the thing is, what are you going to do about it? You know, are you going to listen to Christ, or are you going to listen to yourself or others? In verse 4, he says, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice. Guys, if there's anything I can convey to you, anything I can get across to you about the Word of God, choose to rejoice. It's not a feeling. Fill your mind with the Word of God. When you live on the emotions, that's how the enemy gets you. The enemy uses emotion, because once you're emotional, he can guide you into whatever. Because you'll be all fired up and he's like, this is why, and then you'll just react. But God gave us the Word for wisdom, understanding, knowledge, so we can recognize the bait stick when we're being trapped, when we're being lured. When the enemy's trying to get us into a situation, we have sound mind. In Timothy, I'm not giving you the spirit of fear, but a power, love, and what? A sound mind. A mind that can reason through a situation. That can see clearly. Right? That can see clearly what's going on. So clearly, rejoice. That doesn't mean, Paul, guys, this is the man that was beat. Jesus had those lashes. Remember in Passion of Christ, see the cat nine tails getting his flesh ripped out? What was it, 5 times Paul had that done? 40 lashes minus 1, because 40 is just too much. Must be 39 was the breaking point. Beaten with rods 3 times. That'd be like exact. Stone. If you guys, what's that?
Stone.
Yep. You can stone the guy to kill him. Yeah. It'd be like, imagine Zach. Imagine several of you grab and lay him on the dolphin's feet right here and beat his feet with rock. With a big rock. Bam. Until his feet are just killing him. So he can't walk. These are the things that Paul went through. Paul was in prison, shipwrecked, bit by a viper. His own countrymen robbed him. He got robbed. I don't know what he had. Maybe they took his tents. I don't know what. I'm sure they got whatever he's probably. But here he is. Here's that guy saying rejoice. Imprisoned all the time. And he's the one saying rejoice always in the Lord. Rejoice. Again, he says rejoice. It's a choice. It's a choice to rejoice. That's what the Pastor Dan says. A choice to rejoice is right. Anytime it rhymes, I figure it's Pastor Dan. But it is a choice. And so it's a choice to rejoice that I'm in Teen Challenge. Hey, I rejoice because I'm where God wants me. Don't matter how I feel, maybe pain in the night, rejoice coming in the morning, because I see it through. I believe God called me here. I believe God's going to see me through. And I believe there's going to be fruit at the end of this rainbow, man. At the end of this challenge, at the end of this journey. There's going to be something that's from God that the enemy's not going to be able to shake in me anymore. But I'm going to have to choose to rejoice and endure through it. Doesn't mean that it's going to be happy, man. It means you're going to go through trials. How are you supposed to change unless God shows you what needs to change? He's got to shake you up, squeeze you, so what's in you comes out. And then when you're like, whoa, I didn't know that was in me still. Now you know what to work on. Get along with God, you can pray. And start saying, okay, God, get that vileness out of me. Get that lust out of me. Get that pride out of me, whatever it is. And guys, you're not alone. We're all in the same boat. At least we're bold enough to admit it. Plus, our drugs found us out. but the world's full of it, man. Man, it's full of it. But God, when you choose to rejoice, man, you're going to have different vision of what you're going through. Because then you can see God's hands on it, and you're like, you know what, I'm good, man. Okay, how many of you work out? Okay. There are certain positions that are very painful, right? Where you have to convince yourself, just make it, you know, a minute, 2 minutes, what, I don't know. But you gotta bear through something, right? You're learning to rejoice through it. Why? Tell me, why do you rejoice through that?
Because there's a reward.
Amen. That's absolutely it, man. Yep. Now, can you imagine the reward of God? I rebuke you, garbage man. Let's go get him. Let's go shut this guy down. No, we need him to get the garbage out of there. That's a good feeling. My house when we get the garbage after they kick. Every time I pull in the cans, I'm always happy, man. Yeah. You know, that's the spiritual thing, man. Don't it feel good when God gets the garbage out of you? Guys, how many of you, when you cast your crown before God and He takes that thing from you, it feels good, don't it? Rejoice! Because you were endured. And you got to a point where He can take that from you. Amen? That is a good feeling, man. So choice, man. It's a choice. It's a choice to make a choice. And when you mess up, man, repent and move forward. But the more you recognize you have that choice and it's your choice to make, choose Jesus. And when you choose Him, He's going to lead you how to deal with things His way. Build with His fruits. Not the world's way. The world demands that you do it its way. The world is filth, man. Verse 5, let your gentleness be known to all men, the Lord is at hand. Don't fight as the world fights, guys. Gentleness. Jesus was our teacher. How'd He do it? To be mocked. Can you imagine if all you had to do was snap your finger and thousands of angels would come down and just handle it? You know, like that first guy that's sitting there laughing at him? He could have just, all of a sudden, he just took that. Everyone else would have been like, man, don't say a word. Right? He did. He applied gentleness. Because one moment of him using his actual strength, and people would be gone forever, man. There's a little hint to this. If you look it up in John, towards the end of John, it's where, I can't remember the exact chapter, but it's going to be where he's in the garden. They're going to ask him, they're going to say, are you Jesus? And he says, I am He, except they all fell to the ground. There was just a little bit of His power seeping through. And they got back up and still took them because it was the will of the Father. But He applied gentleness. Just like He has applied gentleness in my life, I believe He's applied gentleness in your life. Do you realize the Holy Spirit knows exactly how to lead you to the truth? Knows how to lead you to the next step. He's gentle with you. It helps you get there. He'll convict you and He ain't going to let you have peace until you deal with it. But He knows how to get in there and gentle for you to help you. Amen? He cares for us. That's why He torments us in the way He does. It's love. Because if we can see what He can see, it'd be so much easier for us to surrender it all and follow Him. But we get hopeless and can't see it. But when we can see it His way, we won't give up. Hallelujah. So He applied gentleness. Hallelujah. Verse 6. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God which surpasses all understanding will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. There is a reward of prayer, and that reward is peace. The world's looking for it. The world's looking for peace in a bad way, to the point that it's going to false idols, false gods. False gods to get peace. If the enemy comes only to steal, kill, and destroy, and those false angels, those fallen angels come from him, so therefore their plan is the same. What do you think that false peace, the reward behind it is? It's to capture you. That's what it is. Oh, I'll give them peace for a moment. Give them some of this drug. Give them some of this meditational teachings. Give them some whatever it is. Whatever the world tries to offer. Some stretches. If it's coming in, it's got a plan. That's where I'm talking about being wise. Getting the word, getting knowledge, getting the word of God. See, all you got to do is once you get the foundations of the origin of the enemy, you understand if it comes from the enemy what his plan is. The wages of sin, guys, is death. That's why you all got to die. Because you sin. And I sin. This flesh thing's got to die. I don't know if it'll be today. I don't know if it'll be tomorrow. It could be another 50 years. I don't know.
But we're going to die. The wages of sin is death.
And so whatever the enemy brings is absolutely got a trap. But God's way, he's saying develop a life of prayer. He's saying be anxious for nothing. Well, that's nice. Have you tried not being anxious? He says, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. How many times do you think you complain in a day? Just give me a number. On average. Say all your days of your life. Just kind of make an average.
47
complaints a day?
I think that's small.
Yeah. You ever listen to someone?
Yeah. Man, it's so hot. Man,
that is the worst.
Man, the gym. Man, Kenny. Man, Kenny. Man, this place. Man, I can't believe my family.
Stupid Corona.
I don't know. There's a whole lot more than you can imagine. If you actually listen for it. I had to do that with myself, start to identify how much I do it, and it was way more than I could imagine. And that was me looking for it. Imagine you're not looking.
I remember the first time God highlighted this to me was when I was in jail and I got saved. Because God started causing me to take responsibility for my own actions. And I saw everyone around me blame and complain. It was everyone else's fault while I'm in this situation. And it was everything. It was just everything was a complaint. There was no one like, praise God, they caught me. Man, you had to get me off the street. I was hurting people. I was causing the problems. Thank you, Lord. Yeah, right. But imagine you had that attitude, man. You would come in agreement with God. And then you'd change. Because you would see it. Right? I know when I went to jail, I didn't think of it at the time. But I can look back now and I'm like, oh, praise God. Man, the way I was driving, I'm shocked I didn't run more people over. My actions, if I would have had more weapons than I had, who knows who would have got hurt. All in the name of me getting high. Getting high! So I can have a good time. Let the whole world burn. Right? That was good to throw him in jail. Why? Because I started reading my Bible. I started looking to God. God got a hold of me. But that's an honest inventory. That's me being really, really honest and allowing God to move on me and see that. I don't have to be defensive with God because he's right about every man be alive. So the Bible says, we're wrong and he's right. I'm just learning to agree with his greatness so he can mold and change me. Amen? But as long as it's someone else's fault, guess what? You ain't changing. If it's someone, and there are, don't get me wrong, people do bad stuff. I'm not saying that. Jesus gave the answer for that. You know what he said? Forgive. That's not easy, though, is it? But then, if you don't know what they did, that's what Jesus said. He said, forgive. And I know what they did to him. And he said, forgive. And he knew what was coming. He knew he was going to be thrown up on a cross to be murdered and to be killed, to be a sacrifice for us. And he said, forgive. Amen? But there's a peace that God wants to give you that this world can't sell you. It can sell you the Snuggie. It can sell you a Pet Rock. Or whatever the new thing. What's the new thing? Remember the Chia Pets? Or whatever, I don't know. It's always selling something, man. Gotta get this and then I'll be happy. Gotta get that. Oh, only an American man who can make money off a Pet Rock. Don't gotta feed it, easy to take care of.
Only $19.99.
Yeah, man, free payments. Man, the world's selling masks now, man. Every mask you can imagine, man. You can get them all jeweled up. You can get them with anything that says anything. You need custom made ones now. You can have it say anything. You can have ones that say, I hate wearing a mask. You can have ones that say, I love wearing a mask. At Target, they had a rack where they had a mirror. Think about this, guys. They had a rack with mirror, with masks, while everyone's trying on masks. Do you think that completely undermines what they're trying to say? Like, they're saying, you know, don't spread the... But everyone's going to go, okay, I... Oh, my goodness. In verse 8... So this peace he's talking about, this peace that comes from heaven, not from this earth. Finally, brethren, whatever things are true,
Whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there's any virtue, if there's anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things. The things which you learned and received and heard and saw in me, these do, and the God of peace will be with you. As we go deeper with God, we start to get a peace. Guys, I think I'm on my sixth or seventh time now that I got angry. Happened twice this weekend. Not once, twice. I don't even care anymore. God's giving me peace. Don't get me wrong, the first time I wanted to kill someone, man. I was going to catch me a teenager and I was going to make him pay. You know, I was angry, man. Like, you can't do that to me. You know, I'm up there having to scrub. Anyone having to scrub egg off the wall? Well, just so you know, it sucks. It's not fun. And it's really hard to catch some suckers, man. I'm sleeping at night. They come out at night. I'm sleeping. I can't even get up. I'm old now. I can't run a chain. Even if I caught one, what would I do with them, man? I pray for them. But, guys, I've been learning to get peace. I'm learning to meditate on what's true, just, noble, and pure, and lovely. Here, these people mean harm on our house or whatever, but really they got me praying for them, though. Because they're probably troubled kids that need the Lord. Now they got me on their side. Because God's given me a peace. I don't got a war with the world as it does. They're doing it for Jesus, man. It's not me anymore, it's Jesus. I'm living for God. I'm one of His. Right? So now I'm learning to get this peace so that the world can't. And you know, here's how this helps me. As I start to give thanks to God, my prayer changes. Instead of being like, how could they do that to me, Lord? I'm like, God, praise God, it's not bricks. Praise God, I'm not having to get every window fixed. Praise God, they didn't light the house on fire and kill the kids. Praise God. And God starts to change something in me where I get a different view on it. It could always be worse. Amen? It could always be worse. So, that's a real life situation where God's been transforming me and maturing me and changing my heart so I'm not affected like the world gets affected. I still get mad, don't get me wrong. But I'm learning to seek God and get deeper with Him so He's starting to change me from the inside out. I want to mature in Christ so the world can't offend me. You know, what is it? I already know it's going to kill me one day. It's going to kill you too if you follow Christ. The world hates Christ, hates the light. Read the Bible. Okay, so meditate on those things. But you got to be intentional. Once again, I'm going to go back to the flesh. Your flesh is never going to intentionally do that. It's not trying to look for the good in things. It's trying to look for why I'm upset, why I'm mad, why things aren't working, why is this? Instead of looking at Christ, looking for truth. Verse 10. But I rejoice in the Lord greatly that now at last your care for me has flourished again. Though you surely did care, but you lacked opportunity. Not that I speak in regard to need, for I have learned in whatever state I am to be content. You learn to meditate on these things, and then no matter what you go through, you learn to be content. Content is, hey man, teen challenge for a year, no problem. This is great. I'm going to follow God, man. I'm going to get filled up as much Jesus as possible and go do the work of God if He permits me to. That's if, you know, the world doesn't end by the time I get done with Teen Challenge or this or that or whatever. You know? Setting the course, man. Following God. Being content. God, I'm your vessel. Whatever, for good or for bad, whatever you put me through, I worship you. You're worthy to be worshipped. It's not about me. I remember my wife helped me with that. When I was a pastor back in the day at this church, I was really fighting with the worship. And it wasn't the worship I liked. And I was really struggling with it. I was trying to change the worship. And my wife just had a way. She goes, Nick, it's not about you. Oh, that house. And then my pride came out, right? Yeah, it is. What I like is good. Everyone else is like, what I like. But I realized it's about God. Well, I'm going to go to China or Africa and change their worship. They're going to worship how they worship Jesus. And I'm going to learn how to worship with them. Amen? Because it's about Him, not about me. Amen? I want to be content in whatever situation I'm in. And I don't know until a minute whether I'm content or not. And once, see, we get used to structures. When those structures get messed with, man, we can get very uncomfortable.
command, putting everything we have into Christ and not into this world. Guys, when you put your hope in this world, do you know this world's going up in flames? Do you know that it's not going to get better, it's going to get worse? There's going to be wars. There's going to be famines. There's going to be such ungodliness. It's horrendous, man.
That's what the Bible says.
It doesn't say it's going to get more peaceful and rejoicing. So if you put your hope in that, you're doomed. You're doomed if you put your hope in that. There might be moments. There might be another decade of peace. I don't know. Another 100 years, another day. I don't know. There's pockets. But the Word of God says that that's the direction it's going in. It says it'll be like the days of Noah, where it got so bad with violence and all this other stuff that God had to flood the earth.
That means one down and out.
Yeah. Yep. Amen. Amen. And like the days of Sodom, where when they saw angels, they were tempted to go after angels. No fear of God. Right? And so we know that. So your contentment and peace can't come from the world. It can't be like, oh man, everything's good, so I'm good. No, it can be bad all around you. Storms, tornadoes, hurricanes, and all kinds of stuff. You can have peace within you. Peace that's in here. You can rejoice that I got a home I'm going to. Oh, I might have to tarry for a little bit longer, but I'm going home. Be with Jesus forever and ever. Amen. So until then, I can tell people the good news, the gospel. Amen. But we got to get that settled in our heart, because if you think it's going to get better and better, you're going to be fooled. And you're going to be let down. Verse 11. Not that I speak in regard to need, for I have learned whatever state I am to be content. I know how to be abased, and I know how to abound. Everywhere and in all things I've learned both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. That verse is the most misquoted scripture of all time. Well, maybe the judge, let's not be judged kind of one. That one's pretty bad too. But people take it as a superpower scripture that I can be victorious in everything. It means I can survive and endure through anything. It don't matter what comes my way. It doesn't matter if they give me 10 years. Kenny comes in and says, you're doing 10 years of teen challenge. Be like, man, with God, I can do all things. I can do this. If that's what God is calling me to do. But how many of you are like, oh, I'm out of here, man. What if you're outside the will of God? What if the cloud by day and the fire by night is here? You going to walk away from God? See how much peace you got. And that's not easy, man. Because then that's where your will and the will of God are conflicting. You will never have peace under your own will. Your own sandcastle gets washed away every time one wave comes. It'll take it every time, man. Whatever you're building, moth-eaten, rust, it'll fall apart. Thieves and robbers will come and steal it. God says he's come to give you that which can never be stolen.
Hallelujah.
We got to be ready for trials. You got to be ready for trials, man, being built up. What if I told you, and I don't know, but what if you men are being built up to be martyred? What if you're being built up to be killed for Jesus Christ? What if that is your calling? What if your calling is to be burnt at a stake? We gotta be built up in the Lord, not built up in the world. The world's gonna say, you know the false prophets for the beginning of in the Old Testament always and out always said the same thing, peace, peace. They always say peace, peace, more peace. Right now there's prophets out there saying peace, peace, everything's getting better. We'll see. We gotta let Christ build us up in here. Get a mindset that nothing is going to change me. Guys, Richard Wurmbrand with Voice of Martyrs in Romania. Romania got attacked by communism. And when communism came in, all the pastors but one united with it and said, this is so great. Communism is just wonderful for the church and for the community and everything. Richard Wurmbrand got up and said, no, this ain't of Jesus. He got ended up getting launched into a 14 years of prison in Romania. Beat all the time. You know what his comment one time was?
He said, me and the guard both get what we want. And all the prisoners looked at him and said, what are you talking about? He says, they get to beat me and I get to share the word of God. Because they said, every time you share the word of God, we're going to beat you. This guy was tough for Jesus, man. The rest of them, all these pastors and priests caved right away and said, oh, soon as persecution came, soon as their own life was threatened, they were like, oh no, this is good. Not Richard, man. You want to be like Richard, or you want to be like the rest of those men? You know? What do you do when the eye of the enemy points at you in your direction? You've got to be built up in the Word, man. Built up in Christ, not built up in this world. This world is ever changing. America will one day be gone. Football will one day be gone. All these things will be gone, man. All rubble. It'll fade away. It'll be gone. Guys, your own legacy will be gone. You know, and I say this a lot in level one, you know your parents' names, and you know their parents' names. Most people don't know their parents' names, and almost nobody knows the names after that. Right? Think about it. Do you? That's how quick your legacy's gone. I want you to think about that. What really matters? What are we building in this world? What are we building? Are we building that which can never fail, or are we building that which will fail? When you build in Christ, those who built in Christ thousands of years ago, we're building today. That carried on. And will.
I got it very good. Now I'm just gonna skip past them.
So greet, and I'm going to go to verse 21. Greet every saint in Christ Jesus. The brethren are with me, greet you. All the saints greet you, but especially those who are Caesar's household. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. Guys, I'll never forget the first week I went on street witnessing. Back in the day, I was running from the church. I couldn't find a home, man. I was pretty intense, coming from the drug world and trying to figure out how to be in church. But I met God and I needed to find a church. And I remember I finally found Jesus' life. It was a long story, but I ended up going there. And Pastor Dan right away was like, you should come out witnessing with me. And I didn't know what I was doing. We went out. And I'll never forget it, man. I got called every name in the book. Spit at. Just treated like garbage, man. Just trying to tell people about Jesus. And I'll never forget. I will never forget. When I went to church that Sunday, I wept and I wept and I wept. It was just little kids up front singing some songs, which is cool. I don't even know what the message is about, but it was to be in the presence of believers where I wasn't under hostility. The world is so hostile towards God. The world is so hostile towards Jesus. A lot of the world hates Jesus, right? But man, to be in the presence you guys have right here, you're not going to know it now. But down the road, if there is a down the road, you'll look back and I guarantee you'll be like, man, it was good things there. God was moving. God really helped me, man. God gave me peace there. You know, there's good things. I know. How long I know? I mean, for 14 years, I've been talking to men that have come and gone from here. And they all say the same thing, man, that God was doing stuff here. This is a place of peace. This is a place where God's moving on you and doing stuff. So, I just want to end with this. He said, rejoice. And again, I will say rejoice. Make a choice. Make a choice to rejoice. Make a choice to rejoice in God. And say, God, thank you that you spared my life. Thank you that I'm here. Please, teach me how to come out of self and to come into you. And live in you and live for you and live through you. Because that's where the peace is. That's where you're going to see a change. And that's when you're going to get a boldness, man, like the world's never seen. Because the world can't kill that which is already dead to the world. Amen? When you're alive in Christ, you're dead to the world. And he will build up your gifts and your talents to bring forth the gospel. Some of you, I believe, have the boldness, the tenacity to go into countries to bring Bibles where they say you can't. Some of you have the boldness to walk up and say, I'm going to say Jesus the only way, even if the world says we'll kill you. I believe that. I believe there's some of you in here that will do that. Amen. I pray that you stay in the Word and you get encouraged and you get built up in that. Because I have no idea what's coming, man. But as for me, my house, I'm following the Lord. I'm going with Jesus, even if he's unpopular. Even if 99% of the world say they hate him and don't want anything to do with him, they call him all kinds of names and they do whatever. I'm with him, man. He's the one that saved me.
in that jail cell when I was dead and gone on drugs, and there was nothing good in me. He poured his life into me. I'm with him. Whether it's popular, whether it's trendy, or it's not. Amen? And I really hope, guys, that you're getting encouraged in the Word. You read the Word. Yes, let us teach, but you get in the Word to see if you can confirm what we're saying is true. Right? You study. You got a Bible. Does everyone here have a Bible? Is there anyone that doesn't have a Bible? Are you reading the Bible? Daily. We just looked at a statistic last week that said 90% of the church in America claims to read their Bible daily. 90%. I want you to think about that. Your strength, your spiritual strength comes from reading from the Word of God.
Or hearing.
Or hearing. Yes. Amen.
I want that again. Sorry, Jeremy. Heavenly Father, I thank you for these dear brothers in Christ, Lord. Father, I pray that they would get truth, Lord. Lord, I don't want them to be entertained in the flesh, to feel good in the flesh, but I want them to be challenged and convicted in the heart for true change that leads to godliness, that leads to righteousness, that leads to the truth. Father, I pray that you would do a work from the inside out that would give them boldness to be the men of God you call them to be in this generation, to be bold for you, to love their families, to show love to the foreigner, to show love to the widow, to show love to the orphan, to show love to those that are hurting and broken and need, to those that are hungry, that these men would show love, not only with the action, with the things to supply, but with the truth of the Word of God. I pray that you would mix that all together and give them the strength, Lord, through you to do these things. We love you and honor you and thank you in Jesus' name.